Embroidered Truths, A Needlecraft Mystery, by Monica Ferris, read by Melissa Hughes.
Toda es según el color del cristal con que se mira. Everything depends on the color of the glass you see through. Spanish saying. Chapter 1. It was a glorious spring morning in Excelsior. Trees were showing off their bright new leaves, and while tulips were dropping their petals, lilacs and lily of the valley were sweetening air, already throbbing with the call of robins. Betsy would have left the door of Cruel World open if her shop manager Godwin had been there. Uncharacteristically, he was late, so she had to keep it closed so its bing would warn her of a customer's entrance. She was busily rearranging the back of the shop. The idea came from Susan Greening Davis, whose newsletter had become Betsy's great guide. The layout of a shop should be changed at intervals of, say, 6 months, suggested Ms. Davis. Regular customers typically went to the same spot to look at familiar stock, and moving merchandise to a new spot would make them hunt around and perhaps discover a new designer or even a new skill. One of the happiest things a shop owner can hear is a customer crying, "I didn't know you had these." Interestingly, rearranging the layout would often bring a similar cry from an employee, occasionally even a shop owner. Of course, if something has been on a shelf so long even the owner has forgotten it, it should go into the deep discount basket by the cash register forthwith. On the other hand, there is, or should be, a pattern to a shop layout, a way of drawing the customer in, teasing with a spinner rack of cute and inexpensive charts, then another one of new flosses, and yet another of the familiar and popular, and so on, building desire until the customer finds herself standing before a display of expensive kits, the hunger to buy at a peak. Or so Betsy hoped. She was standing on a little ladder, reaching to rearrange one of the track lights so it shone on the lovely new Krynek silks when she heard, "Betsy? Betsy, are you in here?" The voice came as something of a shock, because she hadn't heard the door make its annoying bing. Betsy jumped down and hurried out between the two stacks of box shelves that divide the needlepoint knitting area from the counted cross-stitch area. "Here I am. Oh, hello, Mrs. Wells. When did you come in? I didn't hear the door." Mrs. Wells, a regular customer, turned to look at it. "You know, I didn't either. Do you suppose—" She went to the door, opened, and closed it again. It did not emit its harsh ring. "How about that?" she said. Then, "I'm here to pick up my Spectrum canvas." "Oh, wait till you see it. It looks wonderful." Mrs. Wells had recently finished stitching a needlepoint canvas using a chart rather than stitching over a canvas with the pattern already painted on it. Painted canvases cost hundreds of dollars, while the chart was a mere $25, plus materials, of course. Betsy had seen an ad for the Amy Bear chart in an issue of Needlework Retailer and ordered it on spec. Mrs. Wells's glad cry on seeing it on Betsy's shelf prompted Betsy to order two more. Now Betsy went behind the big desk that was her checkout counter and picked up a 14-inch square wrapped in brown paper. She carefully picked the tape away from one end of the package to disclose a framed circle of 12 segments, each segment a different color, done in squares and rectangles of different stitches. Like a proper color wheel, the colors ranged from cool purple and blue to hot red and orange. It was the stretching, matting, and framing Mrs. Wells was here to pay for today. She had selected an antique gold frame that was a perfect choice. "Wow," said Mrs. Wells, reaching for her checkbook. "You did a great job," agreed Betsy. "And so did Heidi." Heidi was Betsy's finisher. "Where's Godwin this morning?" asked Mrs. Wells a few minutes later, as she stood at the door looking around, the retaped needlepoint piece under one arm. "He's a bit late this morning," said Betsy. "I expect him any minute." She tried to keep the concern out of her voice. Godwin was rarely more than a few minutes late, and then he always called to say what had happened and when he'd be in. But today the shop had been open an hour with no sign or signal. Mrs. Wells left, and Betsy went back to the track lighting.
Betsy!
Again she was startled by the voice of someone in her shop without the warning bing. But it was Godwin's voice, and it sounded distraught.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.